Yeah, I always try to pick one name. See if I can think about that one person. So when you look at them, there's just a lot of names. And I always wonder when I pick a name, what kind of life they would have led. Ernest Ritchie. Probably Ernie Ritchie. Probably a college person. Just gone.
That's all you can do.
These were the best of the best in the U.S. Army. Glad Dad's name's not on there.
Second Air Division of the 8th United States Army Air Force was based in England during World War II. From 1942 through 1945, they flew B-24 Liberator bombers to attack the German war machine. In daring daylight raids, they braved the flak of thousands of anti-aircraft guns. They risked the deadly fire of determined German fighters. Many were wounded, many captured. Nearly 7,000 Second Air Division airmen gave their lives to win victory in Europe. Near the end of the war, three officers of the 2nd Air Division had an idea, a memorial library for their fallen comrades. Milton Arnold, commander of the 2nd Wing, was one of the officers.
We saw that some of the people were putting in windows in Westminster Abbey and other things of that. And England, as you know, and Europe is full of statues. So we decided we ought to do something a little differently. So it occurred to us that that would be a living thing, would be an adjunct and an annex to the library. We ran into the problem of raising money and figuring on how to do it and having the approval of the different people. The British, this would be a British annexed to their thing and be officially a part of the British Empire. Well, the British Empire is so tied up and so deafening, as you know, that the ruling person of England is head of the Church of England. So we had a lot of people who were not of that faith.
They talked to the chaplains of different faiths. The Protestant thought it was a good idea. The Jewish chaplain approved it.
We found that the Catholic chaplain, and at that time we had a remarkable man down the 389th that I remember was Father Beck. And but he was not the chief of chaplains for the division. So we went to him, and he thought that, well, he wasn't so sure that this would go over very well.
Commander Arnold had an energetic adjutant, Gordon Ickes.
So I said, well, why don't you go over and talk to the Pope? Which he did. I didn't have any, give him any letter, I didn't have anything else. And here he was, a lieutenant, and he talked himself into an interview, a personal interview with the Pope. And the Pope thought it was a delightful idea and approved it and gave him his blessing and came back, and everything then worked out fine.
In the spring of 1945, an appeal for funds was made to the 2nd Air Division by the division commanding general, Major General William E. Kepner.
A number of men in the division have for some time thought it appropriate for us to create in this area a memorial to these gallant comrades as a shrine to which their families and loved ones, and indeed many of us, may return in years to come.
The £20,000 raised by the 2nd Air Division was presented to the Lord Mayor of Norwich to establish a trust fund for the memorial.
I speak for all the men in my command when I say that the memorial to be constructed with these funds will be to them, and they hope to their many friends in this part of England, a symbol of those ideals: life, liberty, and the right to the pursuit of happiness.
The 2nd Air Division Memorial Room was completed and dedicated in 1963. It soon became a place where both English and Americans could go to learn about the war and remember those who sacrificed their lives for freedom. The library became the home of the Roll of Honor, a book of remembrance with the names of the nearly 6,700 2nd Air Division men who died.
I think it's the greatest ties that two countries can have, to have this sort of a joint library. And for the future of the children from not only these two countries, but all the other countries in the world, really.
In 1994, a devastating fire at the Norwich Central Library destroyed the 2nd Air Division Memorial Library and the Roll of Honor.
Fire broke out early this morning at the Norwich Central Library as cleaners set to work. One of them reported hearing a loud bang, and flames quickly spread throughout the building, but no one was injured. Hundreds of thousands of books and many valuable records were completely wiped out. This includes the American Air Division Memorial Library, a unique record of the activities of U.S. servicemen who were stationed in Norfolk during the Second World War.
It is where the fire is believed to have started. What Bud Korndyke and Richard Kennedy saw was the charred remains of their memorial library. It was in memory of the 6,700 airmen who gave their lives in World War II. But from this disaster, there promises to rise from the ashes another living memorial to all those men.
I flew 30 missions over here during World War II as a pilot. And when we got on that last mission, you know, we came back, we kissed the ground. In some cases, we were tossed into a water trough to celebrate that. That was our last mission. But at our age, we have one last mission.
Anyway, it's wonderful to have you back. It really is. And the whole of the city is very excited, very excited.
Undaunted by the tragedy of the terrorist attack on the World Trade Center weeks earlier, the 2nd Air Division returns to England.
As you know, in this country, the same as in yours, after the awful events of September the 11th, our security is tight in Norwich. Fortunately, you've got the top security team who's looking after us all week. But there's just various things to remember, and one is name tags. And then on the official dues, we'll all be moving on the same coach, and you'll have a trust governor who will have his ID tag, which is like mine. Okay, have a nice journey down to Norwich.
This week, the 2nd Air Division and their English friends will dedicate their new memorial library and the Roll of Honor. Bud Korndyke is back for his last mission. Like many veterans, he brought his family.
And for those who haven't been or have been a long while ago, then this is the center of Norwich. Castle Museum.
The ancient Norman castle and the narrow streets of Norwich welcome the return of wartime friends. At first, the crowd of people outside the Hotel Nelson appears to be a warm British welcome for the Americans.
These aren't yours, are they? I think there's possibly a fire call.
That's
in our building. Is that? Oh, right. That's the answer. I thought there probably was something like that.
What is it?
There's a bomb alert fire alert in the building over there. Couldn't happen to a nicer place. Tax office.
Tax office.
Well, I think we've arrived. I think we made it. You got all these young people with us, too.
Your family, huh?
My family. My caregivers.
Caretakers.
Caretakers, I should say. Oh.
The tiny village of Barsham, the first stop for the 2nd Air Division.
Yeah, lovely.
Well.
Oh, yeah.
The 467th Bomb Group is invited to a special memorial service for one of their crews.
And then Rackheath is another, say, 3 miles, so they were nearly home, and shot down.
Dennis Sproul was an 11-year-old boy when the 467th, returning one night from bombing Ham, Germany, was followed by German fighters. Lieutenant Staley Reed's crew would not make it home to Rackheath.
It must have been coming over that area somewhere. To have got into that corner, I would have thought
it was the smell.
More from the south.
You know, it was the burning oil, aviation spirits, and of course there was the smell, unfortunately, of the bodies, because 6 crewmen died just over the road from here.
From the day of the crash, Dennis Sproul and the villagers wanted a memorial. He planted daffodils that return every spring to light the field in memory of the crew. Finally, the village was able to create a memorial.
I just wish all the vets and all the American people.
Dennis Sproul is sad not only for Lieutenant Reed's crew, but also for the Americans who were lost in the tragedy of September 11th.
It's been so sad this last 2 months.
I felt that I wanted to see it. This is my first visit back since the war, and it brings back the memories. And it's actually a part of history that I participated in. History in the sense of something that's generations should probably think about once in a while.
The memorial is a permanent reminder of part of Barsham's history and the debt we owe to the young men who tragically lost their lives in the crash.
Age shall not weary them.
Reverend John Buchanan remembers the crash as a boy too.
At the going down of the sun, and in the morning, we will remember them. almighty and eternal God, from whose love in Christ we cannot be parted, either by death or life, hear our prayers and thanksgivings for all whom we remember this day.
What a lovely morning, Joe. As it should be for the Second Air Division Association, definitely.
As a boy, David Hastings hung around Second Air Division bases. Later, he served in Britain's Royal Air Force. Through all these years, he's been a faithful friend of the Second Air Division.
But you'll soon get your first view of the forum very shortly. There it is, you can just see it coming out.
Out of the ashes of the old library rises the forum on the Millennium Plain. Within it, the 2nd Air Division Memorial Library. David Hastings gives Helen Dzenowagis and Terry Gregory, wives of 2nd Air Division veterans, an early look before Wednesday's big dedication.
So here it is, here's the forum. But you can see how well they've matched the bricks of the City Hall and all the other adjoining buildings. And they've tidied up the pavements. The whole thing is. And our memorial library is just down there on the ground floor. Here's the memorial library there in that curve. I'm just itching to see your faces when you get your first glimpse of the forum from the inside. Okay, welcome to the forum, the first bit of it. Well, what do you think of that? Did you ever think you'd see a building as beautiful as that in the city centre? And the glass wall and St. Peter Mancroft? Oh, just a brilliant building. Yeah? What do you think? It's good, isn't it? It's good. Well, that's what the 2nd Air Division deserve, nothing less. We promise you we'd rebuild it much, much better. Isn't that quite something? We've got the prime site on the ground floor. That's going up to the adult library. The children's library is on the ground floor. One of the friends, David, Neil and Pearl, who've done so much work for the Memorial Library.
Chairman of the Friends?
Yes, the Chairman of the Friends of the
Friends
Memorial.
Of the 2nd Air Division Memorial.
Memorial, yeah.
A beautiful job, a beautiful library.
Yes. It's a lovely building. Now there's the good view. That, I think, is the view that sums it up. The way you can just look out through the glass wall into St. Peter Mancroft Church. That, I think, is absolutely stunning. And at night, it's even more stunning. And this is where we'll all sit on the opening, and the Wyndham College youngsters will play on the bridge. So if we have a day like this, it's going to be lovely.
I can't tell you what it means to us, because so many of the men, they were just scared, just knew something was going to happen, they weren't going to make it. They've just lived for this for 2 years, and I know they'll just be overwhelmed.
With the 8th Air Force symbols, that's the whole of the library through there. As you can see, it's twice the size of the old one. And witchcraft hanging in the door as you come in. Alfred.
Hello, how nice to see you.
And you.
Very nice to see you.
And you.
I just haven't.
Now, one of the founder governors, Alfred Jenner.
Hello there.
And Andrea Huff, your 2nd Air Division Fulbright Scholar Librarian, and Derek Hills, the Trust Librarian. And of course that wonderful mural, which tells the story of the whole of the 2nd Air Division stay here, right from the hoisting of the first Stars and Stripes, through to the WACS and the ground crew, and the missions, and Jimmy Stewart, and the children, of course, and the GI Bride, and then the final end when you flew home. So we tried to cover it all in that lovely mural. And of course there, Joe, you have the new shrine area, which, thanks to those wonderful embroidered banners, is quite stunning, I think so. And the WAC key, of course, has been restored as it was, and the Roll of Honour and the crosses are from Mattingly now, are the backdrop. You've got the tail fins, Mike's picture, and a lovely model of George Wright, and then, of course, as in the old library, all the group's history is in there, so people can just come
check out.
The library has many special collections. Robert Dubowski, a pilot with the 389th Bomb Group, donated his parachute for the library's memorabilia collection.
This is a piece of my parachute that I used during the war on the 16th of January, 1945, coming back from Dresden. As we crossed the Rhine River on two engines, the third engine was knocked out and the entire crew bailed out, all 13 of us, and we all made it okay, barely.
You notice it carries the highly decorated Dragon nose. This, most of the 2nd Air Division groups had an aircraft painted this way.
Mike Bailey donated a collection of paintings of aircraft from each of the bomb and fighter groups.
When the original 2nd Air Division Memorial Room was conceived, I'd wandered in the room several times and there was no photographs or paintings of the B-24. And I got rather incensed once when I heard a schoolboy talking to his dad and saying, "Dad, which type of airplanes did the 2nd Air Division fly?" And I was horrified to hear this fellow say, "Oh, the B-17 Fortress." And I thought myself, my God, you know, we've got to redress this somehow. So that's the best thing to do is do a painting of a typical B-24 Liberator of the 2nd Air Division.
I've toured America quite a bit with my son, and there's not much in America that remembers your veterans, I don't think. And if they wish to be remembered and be associated with the years that they fought, they come to Norwich, don't they? They really do. And I think you've only got to look around. They're more at home over here in remembering than anywhere in America.
George Wright, inspired by a letter from a son of a veteran, spent 9 years and thousands of hours to create models of the assembly ships of the 14 bomb groups.
I watched the Battle of Britain unfold as a small boy, 9 years old, and war was like a glorification for me. It was, they were all heroes. And maybe the one thing I did learn was that, having learnt the history of the 2nd Air Division to a very small degree, that nearly 7,000 of those heroes died that helped England survive. Yeah, perhaps I learnt a bit more about myself and why I'm still here. Yeah, perhaps I did.
Another collection that helps make the library a living memorial is the Military Video History Project, with over 1,000 interviews. 2nd Air Division veterans, family members, and English friends tell their stories so that one can see, hear, and appreciate what the men on the Roll of Honor were like and what they endured.
I want to dedicate my recording on this tape to two of my men, one who was killed on a mission over Brunswick, Germany.
The feeling that these people have about what they did and what they accomplished. And I think it's remarkable because most of these people were not regular soldiers or regular Air Force. They were civilians that had no experience. This was 95% of these people in this division, which was 60,000 people.
The bell was ringing and the pilot was hollering, "Bail out, bail out." As I turned around, I saw Bateman, my navigator, hanging one part of his back was against the nose, the strut, and he was hanging there, rather bloody, and he was just staring at me. And I tried to grab his boots to haul him in, but the slipstream took him away, and he went out without a chute. I remember distinctly missions before when I talked in the barracks with him about, "Please put your chute on, and at least one hook." But he felt he couldn't navigate because he was navigating against the board, the table in front of the pilot's feet. He was such a conscientious man, he said he'd get it when he needed it.
Three wars left ace fighter pilot Robin Olds with a lot of memories, but the one that's etched forever in his mind is of a crippled B-24 trying to make it back alone from deep inside Germany.
And I started to head out, and I looked back, and here was a lone B-24. The last bomber out of the last box, and he had one burning, one feathered, and two churning. And I said, that guy could use a little moral support. You know, I'd been talking to him, steering him around the flak concentrations, because we knew those by heart. And all of a sudden, I was above, up about his 9 o'clock position, weaving, watching. All of a sudden, flame went from left outboard to right outboard. And I screamed at them, get out, get out. And the old bird kind of rolled over, she started down. And I saw three chutes. And I flew home in tears.
So I think what I learned to have a tremendous regard for the American, not just as a good guy, but as a highly dependable type of person that could go out and be asked to do a job and then come back and do it.
Americans, young, inexperienced, who they were and what they did 50 years ago determined the fate of nations. What they did shaped the lives and destinies of millions of people. What they did when they were young and inexperienced in war reversed the course of a world gone mad. Collection also includes 25 documentaries that portray the friendship of the British and the Americans. As well as help the Roll of Honor come to life.
The bodies of these men and women rest in the bosom of the earth, their souls in keeping with God. But their spirits are with us to the ending of the world. And what they did for us can never die.
There's Joe Stephan.
What'd you
say? Yeah.
Is this
Joe Stephan? He was 448.
The heart of the Second Air Division Memorial Library is the Roll of Honor, for all to see and to remember.
I think it is a unique memorial. I know of nothing in the world of libraries that supports any sort of mission like this. We've established such enormous bonds of friendship between veterans and between public here, and that will go on and extend itself through future generations.
As a librarian, I think this was just a brilliant thing for the Americans to have come up with as a memorial. And I just think it's an incredible example of American ingenuity. Where else have they come up with something like this? I don't know of another memorial library like this. So I just think it's something very special, and I hope that 100, 200 years from now that people will still be able to enjoy it and find that connection between the two peoples.
We tried to make it a proper modern memorial that will last for generation after generation, so nobody will ever forget you.
Look at this!
Two ladies, wow! How do I get some luck? How do I get so lucky?
Generations of Americans and British meet to further the bonds of friendship and carry on the values of the passing generation. The first meeting of the Heritage League of the Second Air Division Association and the Friends of the Memorial Library is packed with children who brought their parents.
So the theme of this week, I think as far as all of us are concerned, is the beginning of the handing over of the of the banner, because our generation now is getting on a bit.
Dave O'Neill is chairman of the Friends, a group of English people who assist Americans when they come to visit the air bases and the library.
You see them, you've seen them for years coming back at different times, and you know, sometimes they age, we all do. I mean, I'm in my 70s now, you see, and I was only a boy then, and yeah, it's great to see them all again.
Irene Herner is the president of the Heritage League, Americans who perpetuate the legacy of the 2nd Air Division.
I brought my daughter and I brought her friend. Becky is here. They've traveled from Missouri to join Mom and Dad, who came from California. Dad was a pilot in the 453rd Bomb Group stationed at Old Buck.
I'm with my grandfather. He's part of the 93rd Bomb Group, and he was a bombardier and a navigator. There you go. Perfect.
Thank you, Mike.
And I discovered that within three generations, that 99.9% of everyone who comes to this planet is completely forgotten. And one of the most wonderful things, I believe, for the citizens of Norfolk is that first you fought for us, what wonderful courage you showed, what greatness, how your lives were changed. And thank you for all of what you have done. I just pray that none of us will ever forget, and this wonderful library will stand there, just like Norwich Cathedral has stood for 900 years. You will not be forgotten.
The recent terrorist attacks left some question as to whether the 2nd Air Division would travel to England for the long-awaited dedication of its memorial library.
I don't think any of us ever expected September the 11th. And I just said to myself, well, I guess we're going to stay home.
Fondly known as Mother Superior, Evelyn Cohen with the Women's Army Corps is a longtime leader of the 2nd Air Division Association.
He said, don't you want to go? I said, yeah, I want to go. Do you want to go? He said, absolutely. So I called Jordan Utall and some of the other vice presidents and said, what are we doing? They said, we're going, those bastards are not going.
Like the 2nd Air Division, the Royal Air Force is committed to the dedication of the Memorial Library.
We will fly for the 2nd Air Division Association. We will march past for the 2nd Air Division Association. And we will parade our four Battle of Britain standards for the 2nd Air Division Association, because no terrorist is going to stop us paying our tribute to you, the 2nd Air Division Association.
Stephen Mendham is a young member of the Friends.
You know, every day goes by is another day of history. You know, it's like this visit, you know, is it going to be their last, or will a few more still come over? You know, it'd be nice if they do, just, you know, so they can come over and see that, you know, we still care what they've done for us, you know.
It is a long ride to the American Cemetery in Cambridge. King and Paula Schultz of the 448th know all the songs. Nelson Becker and his son Nick try to follow along.
It's true.
It's a sin to tell a lie.
Looks great. It's exactly, you know, you see it on TV, you see it in films and stuff, and now you actually get to stand here and look at it, so it's really neat.
How old was your grandfather when he was in the Air Corps?
He was one of the young guys. He was about 18.
How old are you?
I'm 27.
Can you believe that a guy that young was doing all this stuff?
Can't at all. Cannot believe it. I mean, it's remarkable at that age that they actually went out there and did what they had to do.
This is a beautiful place.
Many on the Roll of Honor are buried here. Many more names are on the Wall of the Missing.
Jim Schoolmaster right there.
Almighty God, who has blessed us with the will and the courage to do our duty, we praise you for our comrades whose death kept freedom living. We praise you also for giving us the years we have lived since their departure.
We always come over here and have a remembrance. And place a wreath because we had almost 7,000 of our 2nd Air Division people, our comrades who didn't make it. They contributed greatly to our freedom today.
James Schoniker is the superintendent of the American Cemetery.
We always appreciate your hospitality, and the grounds are always impeccable, and boy, that means a lot to us, even though they're just names up there and such. So thanks again.
Well, we can never say thank enough for what you fellas did for my generation. It's overwhelming. You can see these gentlemen, the way they're walking around. They were young kids at the time, and it's fantastic to see when they come back, like they've done again today.
The Wall of the Missing has over 5,000 names. Robert Cash, with the 492nd Bomb Group, was the sole survivor of his crew of 10 when their plane crashed into the North Sea.
Boy was his pilot.
So I have about 7 crew members here.
All on the same plane?
All on the same plane. James Morrow, 492nd. That was my nose turret gunner. Here's my pilot, George McCoy.
David Ash came with his father, Al Ash, a pilot with the 93rd.
He lost a bombardier who's out there, and one of his, you know, several of his co-officers that he flew with. I imagine it's pretty emotional for these guys to, you know, these guys they knew and hung out with and fought with. Those that didn't make it, I think a lot of the guys feel very fortunate.
That's my bombardier, Howard R. Gilbert, 2nd Lieutenant, 328th Bomb Squadron, 93rd Bomb Group, Heavy. He was born in Ohio on November 18th. No, he was killed November 18th, 1942. I'll never forget that date. That's about, 69 years ago, almost to the day. Or is it 59?
What do you remember most about him?
He had a nice, pleasing smile, personality. Dedication, he was dedicated to his job and dedicated to his country. You always gave the impression that he was totally dependable. He operated well under pressure. For example, he kept his cool when we got back to the base, helped the engineer get the nose wheel down.
Windham, once a wartime hospital where many wounded 2nd Air Division soldiers were treated. Today, a college. The students of Windham have invited the veterans to dedicate a mural.
How are you young people tonight? Good evening. Hi. Fine.
Good evening.
Good evening. Good evening. Good evening. How are you?
Well, I used to come over here to dance. Yeah, we did. This was when it was the hospital. And we had American nurses were here.
What do you think about the kids being here?
Terrific.
I've came to this hospital many times after D-Day to visit the friends that we knew. And to sit and maybe help them write letters home or anything that they needed. I'm very proud to be here. I'm proud of the fact that we have this mural here, because as long as there's an England and as long as there's the city of Norwich, we will be the 2nd Air Division here forever. Thank you. Jordan?
And I think to have the links with both the veterans and their children and their grandchildren, and to perpetuate the link between the college and the United States for us is very important, because it keeps that history alive and it's an important part of our life.
11-year-old Jessica Knights is in the 7th grade.
It's really special because it shows that it wasn't just a school, it was an actual air base and these people were here. They're really nice.
The American Air Museum at Duxford, a former American fighter base, where the British preserve American and English history, honoring the memory of both nations' airmen.
This is the nose of the B-24.
And where were you in that?
That little window.
Up the bubble?
Well, the bubble was part of it.
And then to the side?
Well.
A welcome at the Officers Club by the director, Ted Inman.
The American Air Museum flourishes. We have over 400,000 visitors a year, and they almost all go and see that particular tribute to United States Air Power, which is so relevant to your service and your contribution to our combined history, and so relevant to today's joint engagement in the conflict against terrorism.
Willis Beasley was an aerial gunner with the 492nd. His son, Craig, is a leader with the Heritage League.
And then use that handheld.
Tell me who you brought with you.
My wife, Norma, and my son, Craig.
How did he...
At the bomb site.
Yep. How do you get in there from...
Crawl up by the nose. They crawl, get up from the cockpit.
See, they don't have...
Llewellyn Brown, a pilot with the 93rd, is here with his son, David Brown.
He was big and strong, and we had that airplane. We couldn't pick that wing up.
He's appreciating the history more and more.
That's about all I can remember about it. And then,
so you told him about that?
I think I have.
he'll learn more history here than he ever learned in the United States through reading history books.
Yeah, I'm just loving hearing him tell everything about this. I've got a bunch of questions that he loves to answer. It's like going back 50 years.
Well, Dad, they say the B-24 is covered up in plastic.
Part of it, and yeah. Part of it. I can take it.
You want to see it? You want to see the B-24?
I want you to see it.
Yeah.
Hey. David Neal, chairman with the Friends of the Library, and Bernie Reagan, flight engineer with the 93rd, head for the restoration area.
Look at this birdie boy.
Yeah,
that's the tail end.
Oh, okay.
Tell me where you want to go.
Exactly. From out of the past emerged the remnants of a B-24 Liberator being faithfully restored by the American Air Museum.
You remember it well?
Oh, yes.
Yeah,
yeah, man.
Uh-huh.
See, a lot of the flight engineers took the upper turret. But when they did that, when the airplane was hit, they couldn't leave that upper turret. So I took the waist gunner over here. And I had another gunner on this side here. Now, we're only attacked from one side or the other. So I could always leave my position if I had to take care of the airplane. Anyway.
This aircraft was last one actually in USAF service, and it was modified and used for ice survey work.
I volunteer to fly it, though, if they want to test flight around, just around a patch, you know.
Keith Trigg is the conservation coordinator for the B-24.
When we restore the aircraft, we are planning on them lasting 100 years plus.
Oh, yes.
So we work at very high standards. I mean, it's going to take a long time. I'm not saying it's going to happen overnight, but when it is done, it's going to be done properly.
Wing sections, tail section.
Todd Nicole is an exhibit producer with the museum.
Center section, which is all in one piece at the moment, but they've been working on this now for, I suppose it must be about 4 years now. The engines are here as well.
Oh yeah, you ain't wasting time getting it back again.
You didn't have time to be scared, really.
Yeah.
Are they going to make a real airplane out of this?
I think so.
It's amazing how they take it apart panel by panel by panel. Yeah.
Just, well, they always said that one of the finest restoration places for aircraft is right here at Duxford.
Duxford, yeah.
Yeah.
Ray Strong, with headquarters during the war, brought his granddaughter, Laura Lau.
What do you think, Mr. Strong?
I don't think it's going to fly. But it looked like they're making progress, I'll tell you. That's great. To see this many people still interested and concerned, it makes you feel good to have something like this.
How is it being over here with your granddad?
It's wonderful, wonderful experience. Very proud of him and all these men. I always have been, and it's nice to be here with them.
Look at this. This shows the library, and then you turn it over, and it says the B-24 and the freedom of the city.
Alan Sr., a ball turret gunner with the 446th, designed a commemorative medal for Norwich's Freedom of the City honor.
How gracious the English people have been. They're so genuinely hospitable and thankful for the 2nd Air Division coming back home. And that is an emotional response.
England. Centuries ago, this city of walls and gates barred friend and foe alike. Only military regiments whose troops assured good behavior were granted freedom of the city. The 2nd Air Division Association, should they choose to do so, can soon exercise the privilege of marching through Norwich with bayonets fixed, drums beating, and colors flying. an ancient right few are granted in a city whose history dates back 1,300 years. St. Andrew's Hall. Tonight, the city of Norwich bestows its highest honor, the freedom of the city, upon the 2nd Air Division Association for bravery in World War II and enduring friendship with the people of Norwich.
What a wonderful night. Wonderful, a dream come true, Evelyn.
The town crier opens the freedom of the city. Lord Mayor of Norwich, Councillor Keith Ratcliffe.
I should like to welcome you all, but particularly our American friends, to this very special occasion. We're meeting in a fine medieval hall which the city has owned since the Reformation in the 16th century, and which has been the setting for many notable events in its history. It's therefore very fitting that we should be meeting here for this important occasion, the award to the association of the highest honor which the city can bestow.
John Turner, the city clerk, reads the city council resolution.
And it was resolved unanimously that in recognition of the close historic ties between the city and the 2nd Air Division Association, and to mark the continuing contribution the association has made to the city, in particular, the 2nd Air Division Memorial Library, to admit the 2nd Air Division Association to the honorary freedom of the City of Norwich.
Councillor Nick Williams sponsored the resolution.
Lord Mayor, it is right that to celebrate the contribution made to the defense of our nation by those American airmen and the bonds of friendship between the City of Norwich and the 2nd Air Division Association that have endured for over half a century, that we offer this honorary freedom. It is our way of saying thank you.
Councillor Ian Cousins seconded the resolution.
Relations between our two nations have always been at their closest during times of acute crisis. In the wake of September 11 attacks on America, it is the turn of our country to offer solidarity and support to Americans as best we can. While not really doubting that you would make it here after what has happened, it is nonetheless wonderful that you are. The friendship between the 2nd Air Division Association and the City of Norwich has now endured for nearly 60 years. It is entirely fitting that the city should have marked the relationship and our respect in the most special way possible.
The Lord Mayor presents the Freedom Scroll to Felix Leighton, President of the 2nd Air Division Association.
I'm delighted to give you this scroll which confirms the honor of freedom on your association.
It's with a great deal of humility and pride that I accept this scroll.
Jordan Utall is the honorary life president of the 2nd Air Division Association.
And we get goosebumps when so many of you say to us, welcome home. Be assured that we look upon you and this place where we now have the freedom of the city as part of our extended family. We thank you for being in our lives, and we wish you the best.
So, members of the 2nd Division Association, for all this, and for coming over in such large numbers for this occasion and the opening of the library, undeterred by the terrible events 2 months ago in your own country, along with our highest honor, you have our heartfelt thanks.
By the Lady Mayoress, and the Civic Party will now leave the hall.
What does this mean to the 2nd Air Division? I don't know of any honor that could be possibly greater than this. And I tell you, being here with all these people who took us in so many years ago. It's just remarkable as far as I'm concerned.
Well, I think we've done what perhaps we should have done earlier, and that's give the honour to the association because of all the things that its members did during the war, and indeed afterwards with the Memorial Library and other links that they've kept up.
I must say that everything I ever dreamed about, combat, flying, friendship, was culminated here in East Anglia.
I found the ceremony very, very moving, and I'm immensely proud to have been part of it.
It's a great honour for the citizens of Norwich to be associated with the 2nd Air Division and for us to confer the highest honour which we can on in giving them the freedom of the city.
I think it's an opportunity for us to say thank you for the contribution made both in war and in the 50 years since the war by the 2nd Air Memorial Division.
It's a very, very moving ceremony. We owe so much to these very brave men.
Something, didn't we, many years ago?
It brought me to tears, as did much of this. I choke up easily, but I did a lot of crying this week.
This hospitality that the English have presented us with, and particularly the people in Norwich, is indescribable.
These people are so generous and so kind to us, and to grant us the freedom of the city is very significant, and we appreciate it.
It means that the British haven't forgotten the Americans, and the Americans appreciate what the British have done to express their strong feelings toward the relationship that we've developed during World War II.
Wonderful tonight. Glad to be here. Good show. Brings me to tears.
I think the whole ceremony is very, very moving, and the way they feel about us, we feel about them. We love the city of Norwich and all the people in it.
Means a lot just to be here, to be alive, be a survivor.
It means, again, a perpetuation of the love affair that started 50 years ago. And is continuing today, and hopefully will go on forever.
First trip here for me. Never been to England, never been to Norwich. And it's a special time.
I don't know of anything that could have been done better. And I told them, you got 560 Americans going home bragging about what they saw here tonight. Absolutely.
Norwich Cathedral, school children begin the day before the 2nd Air Division's service of remembrance.
U.S. Air Force servicemen flew from airfields in Norfolk during the Second World War. Many are still alive, now in their 80s, and have returned for the opening of the new section of the Forum.
Morning, David.
A wonderful morning that we're going to bring their roll of honour into the cathedral to be dedicated yet again on this lovely morning.
Marvelous occasion. It's been 50-odd years since I've been back here.
It's particularly special because in all probability, considering the advanced age of most of us, this will be our last as a group. There may be individuals coming back, but as a group, this is probably it. We made it, in spite of everybody.
The recreation of the dedication of the Roll of Honor in the Norwich Cathedral, the same as in the service in St. Peter Mancroft in 1963. Of the standards and the Roll of Honor with their escorts are sons and grandsons of 2nd Air Division veterans and a wartime English friend.
Yeah. So the standards are borne by Craig, Andrew and Peter Ash,
right.
And the Roll of Honor is carried by Dan Butler, Alan Peterson and Victor Dzenowagis.
Right.
Well, it's pretty impressive honor to just to even be a part of this ceremony. It's I happen to have been a retired Navy officer too, so I can kind of sympathize a little better with some of the emotions that come up in a celebration like this.
So you'll be carrying the book, and then one escort here and one escort here.
Okay.
Yeah.
For me, it's really important to take part in something that my grandfather, you know, did so long ago. It's kind of like supporting him and the guys he was with and everything.
40 years after the original dedication, Dan Butler, son of Colonel Dick Butler of the 44th Bomb Group, will carry the Roll of Honor to the altar.
This is the Roll of Honor, 6,700 veterans.
Thank you. Reverend Stephen Platten, the Dean of Norwich Cathedral, welcomes the Americans and remembers the sacrifice of countless young lives in World War II.
Particularly those airmen, American and British, who flew from bases in East Anglia. From here, we will go on to dedicate and bless the new home for the 2nd Air Division Memorial Library within our city's great new Millennium Building.
Bud Corndyke, the pilot, his last mission.
There be of them that have left a name behind them, that their praise might be reported. And some there be which have no memorial, who are perished, as though they had never been born, and their children after them. But these were merciful men whose righteousness had not been forgotten. Their bodies are buried in peace, but their name liveth forevermore.
The Reverend Canon Ivan Bailey, a Royal British Legion chaplain.
As a boy, I heard the sound of heavy aircraft in the early morning, and in the Norfolk skies saw the bomber fleet's mass. And when one could no longer, as it were, see the sky, the aircraft turned east, and our prayers went out to the young men who were on that journey. We remember that they were all volunteers, all imbued with a zeal to fight evil. We remember those who I saw leave but did not return.
Jordan Utall, Honorary Life President of the 2nd Air Division Association.
My Lord Bishop, on behalf of the parents, relatives, and comrades of the more than 6,700 American men who gave their lives, I will request that you dedicate this roll of honor so that they may live in honor.
Peace be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. In the faith of Jesus, we dedicate this roll of honor to the glory of God and in memory of those whose names are recorded. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
The Lord Bishop of Norwich, the Right Reverend Graham James, remembers the thousands of Americans who gave their lives.
There could be no more fitting memorial for the airmen we honor today than a library. Your library helps build peace and friendship. And what better memorial could there be? In this cathedral, we look to the Prince of Peace as our inspiration and guide. And may we in our generation salute those who died for our peace and cherish and defend all that is good with hearts open and arms outstretched. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost be upon you and remain with you now and always.
Ago, the bells of St. Peter Mancroft accompanied the roll of honor to the dedication of the 2nd Air Division Memorial Library.
Thank you.
Royal Air Force Cranwell Band, the United States Mildenhall Honor Guard. The Royal Air Force Coltishall Guard of Honor marches with fixed bayonets under the freedom of the city of Norwich.
On behalf of my fellow governors, may we welcome you all to this gathering in the forum of the formidable new Norfolk and Norwich Millennium Library. Evelyn, the resolution and determination of your members to travel to Norwich following the terrible events of the 11th of September, and with not one falling out of those 80-year-olds or those in their late 70s, that touches us deeply, and we do appreciate you coming. Just as in the darkest days of the Second World War, when the United States stood by Europe, now Europe has stood by the United States in her hour of need. We in the United Kingdom stand shoulder to shoulder with you in America, as you did with us between 1942 to 45.
Lieutenant Lowell K. Hess is my father. My father flew B-24s out of Hethel, and on 15th of February, 1945, he was shot down and imprisoned 15 months as a POW. He's alive and well and living in Plano, Texas, and he is one hell of a man. Ladies and gentlemen, it gives me great pleasure to declare open and jointly with the Lord Lieutenant the new Memorial Library of the 2nd Air Division, United States Army Air Forces. Thank you.
It's my greatest hope that when all of us are gone, and even before, a younger generation will step forward, and that those with relevant responsibilities on both sides of the Atlantic will in the future never hesitate to take whatever steps may be necessary to support, to safeguard, and to guarantee the role of this memorial library for future generations.
A greeting for the 2nd Air Division from Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II.
All of us will remember with everlasting gratitude their bravery and sacrifice in the defense of freedom during this country's hour of need. And I share proudly now with General Hess, representing His Excellency the U.S. Ambassador to Great Britain, the privilege of formally declaring open this new memorial library. Thank you.
To you, the British, I say again, thank you for letting us be part of your lives, and thank God you've been part of our lives. Thank you very much.
2nd Air Division President Felix Leighton asks the Bishop of Norwich to dedicate the 2nd Air Division Memorial Library.
On behalf of the officers, airmen, and women of the 2nd Air Division of the 8th Air Force, United States Army Air Forces, who gave their lives during World War II, and the lasting memory of the friendship and kindness shown by the people of Norfolk County, I ask you, my Lord, to dedicate this memorial library.
Sons and grandsons of 2nd Air Division veterans carry the roll of honor home. Lord Lieutenant Sir Coleman and General Hess open the 2nd Air Division Memorial Library. The Lord Bishop of Norwich, the Right Reverend Graham James.
In the faith of Jesus Christ, we dedicate this memorial library to those men and women of the American 2nd Air Division who gave their lives in the time of war, and all those whose names are inscribed in the roll of honor. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Let us pray. Grant, O Lord, that their memory be not lost, nor their praise cease before thee, who in thy Son has overcome death, and art the source of light and life through all ages, world without end. Amen.
Amen. The
you know, they know how to, they know how to put on a ceremony, and I think it was solemn, it was loving, it was affectionate, it was, it's a tribute.
Quite an honor. It was pretty thrilling to be part of that, and it was neat to hang out behind the scenes and talk to the various airmen and all the Norwich officials. It's been enlightening and quite an honor. Wouldn't have missed it for the world.
God, was I ever 22?
So a dream come true.
Yeah, yeah.
It was the greatest honor that anyone could have been given, quite an opportunity to carry forth the roll of honor of the 6,700 names and memory of what they gave for both our countries, and that they will be remembered forever in this wonderful memorial.
The vicar of St. Peter Mancroft, Reverend Peter Noakes, introduces the Wyndham College Band, conducted by Andrew Day.
Young people of today from the college are now proud to play in honor of the 2nd Air Division their award-winning piece of music entitled The Acclamation, as today is indeed an acclamation.
It's great.
The new 2nd Air Division Memorial Library. Colonel Dick Butler.
So what did you think about your son carrying the role of honor?
Oh, we were so proud, very proud of him doing it, yes.
Ted Inman is the director of the American Air Museum at Duxford and a trust governor for the Memorial Library.
To remember the past and educate future generations for the sake of the future.
A reception at City Hall.
The library to me means an opportunity to present peace in another form between two countries. And to me, that is what it's all about, is to try to build relationships which then become, hopefully, peace throughout the world.
And so the dedication was a very special event, a very memorable day, which I'll never forget. I'm very touched to be involved with it.
Bud Korndike's daughter, Muriel DeGraff.
He was crying. Yeah, he was crying. So he thought it was beautiful.
I lost my wife a year ago. She was really enthusiastic and about coming over here, and I'm sorry that she had to miss it.
Being a trust governor runs in the family for David Gurney.
R. Q. Gurney. So what is this?
He was a governor of the trust, as was my grandfather also before him. So I'm the third generation governor.
It's like a home for Americans. When you come back over here, we feel that the community's got bigger again. It's just wonderful to have you here. And when you've gone home, the Memorial Library is a way of us being able to continue to link with you and to continue to develop friendships.
Well, I think it's great to be here to see the library and to see some of the places where Dad had been while he was stationed here in Norwich. And just to see the legacy of what the 2nd Air Division has left behind is a good outcome of the things that took place a long time ago.
Like most everything else that goes on over here, I get so choked up I can't talk. And I'm starting to turn that way again right now.
How about you, Mrs. Bertipel?
I agree with you. It's very emotional.
But beautiful.
Very good.
It means everything, the fact that we have a memorial of this type, that a stone marker is there, but it doesn't seem to have quite the same meaning as a living memorial like this in a way. I'm just glad to be here to think about the fellows that didn't come back with us, and this is certainly the finest tribute you could give anybody.
The celebration banquet at the Norwich Sports Village.
Dennis, it's good to see you. Have you been behaving yourself?
Very well.
That's good. I'm really glad to hear you have. It's awfully good to see you.
No time for it.
The fifth candle will be lighted in honor of the Ardennes campaign.
The 2nd Air Division and their English friends light 8 candles in memory of those on the roll of honor and for those who have died since the war. Second Air Division veterans are escorted by sons and daughters. Eight candles for remembrance. The 2nd Air Division donates funds to ensure the future of the Memorial Library.
Well, this is just unbelievable. We thank you, all my fellow governors, for this generosity on an incredible scale.
The Right Reverend Graham James quotes from British playwright Tom Stoppard.
And he says this, Americans, they don't stand on ceremony. They make no distinction about a man's background, his parentage, his education. They say what they mean. They're always the first to put their hands in their pockets. They press you to visit them in their own home the moment they meet you. They are irrepressibly good-humored, ambitious, and brimming with self-confidence in any company. Apart from all that, I've got nothing against them.
They like to meet up with the friends that they met, because there's quite a few friends around here. Even the kids that knew them have grown up, so they still keep on the friendship. But what I get mostly from the Americans is they just adore England. You know, it's as simple as that. I think they've got a love affair with England.
The last day before the return to America. Sons, daughters, and grandchildren have come with their fathers and mothers to the old bases and to the villages that were home to their fathers during the war.
Morning, sir. Nice to see you.
Morning. Morning. Oh, be swift, my soul, to answer him. Be jubilant, my feet, our God. Is marching on. Glory, glory, alleluia. Glory, glory, alleluia. Glory, glory, alleluia. His truth is marching on.
That friendship began in the 40s, is carried forward and must be carried forward into the future.
Recognize this. This was on Life magazine. It was taken shortly after we came back from the desert the first time. You're not going to find my picture on here because it's right there.
Al Ash and the 93rd Bomb Group returned to their old base at Hardwick.
Colonel Cool and Major Jurstad
led the 93rd over the target at Pulaski.
The 93rd donates pictures of its famous low-level Ploesti raid to the 93rd Museum.
It was 2 Congressional Medals of Honor, 5 Distinguished Service Crosses, 13 Silver Stars, 318 Distinguished Flying Crosses, and an untold number of Purple Hearts. This may well be the most decoration that any combat unit received for a single battle in the history of warfare.
The sounds of war still echo across the countryside for the men of the 93rd.
And this is the runway.
You see that little line of trees over the back there?
Uh-huh.
That would have been another part of the runway, would have ran that way across there. You've got this one here, and then there's another one runs in line with the dark green trees that go the other way.
This is the one remaining runway which is left now. That wasn't the main one. The main one ran from north to south all the way across in front of us.
We had such heavy loads of gas and bombs that we needed every foot we could get them in the air. And a few of them didn't make it. I saw one take off and suddenly lost an engine. Crash, a big explosion. There were just pieces left.
Brendan Sullivan for my grandpa's reunion. Yeah, he was a navigating bombardier.
Some buildings are long gone. This one survives to provide a refuge for some unusual tenants.
This is my air base when I was here, you know.
The name of the plane was On the Ball.
Radio operator Albert Del Judas brought his wife, Alberta, and daughter, Sandra Comstock.
Sounds like it. Excellent.
A lot of memories here. A lot of guys that... I shot down while we were here, you remember them. Then on the honor roll wall in the hangar, 3 of my buddies that were got killed there on that.
Hey, Dad, here's your radio. Yeah, right. Is it?
That's what Dad was, too. When we all go, because I'm 80 years old. Every one of us are in their late 70s, you know? I mean, after we're gone, I mean, who's gonna come to these things or talk about it, you know? Right? Yeah. So you need the younger people to keep it going.
It's emotional. Very proud of them.
Isn't this wonderful? The family is, we want to know more. And just pass it on. Like, I've got a granddaughter, and we'll groom her so that generation won't forget either. So it's really important to the family. Very important.
Karen Schneider Crane came with her father, Ray Schneider.
So if you want to come in there and...
Here I am sitting right over here.
Oh.
And now when we've had September 11th, I think it also helps to understand the men who fought, and men and women who fought. And now part of it is my generation and those behind me. And what are we going to do? How are we going to behave?
Born before the war, William Sargent Jr. came to search for his father's crew.
I commend to his shorekeeping all the men of the 93rd Bomb Group who died from this airfield.
His father, William Rukert, never made it off the runway on his first mission.
ROTC, University of Illinois, class of 39, summa cum laude, commerce and law. He wanted to be an accountant or a lawyer. He certainly didn't expect to be a pilot. That's what he was. I wish I had met these men 30 years ago. I am so thrilled to be here. England is, I love England. What a nice place. To not meet these gentlemen, and they're leaving us fast now, it would be a real loss. So I am so glad I made it here.
Paul Stison came with his brothers and sisters to stand in for his dad, Roy Stison, who died before he could come for the dedication of the Memorial Library.
His legacy will live on kind of in us. You know, I'm his son.
Vice President Al here, a plaque of the Normandy Veterans Association.
The British veterans of Normandy honor the veterans of the 93rd.
A reminder of the days when we were brothers in arms, and today when we can justly say that we are still brothers. We hope that you will find some comfort in the knowledge that you and yours will forever be welcome here, in our hearts, in our minds, and in our homes.
It's unbelievable that they would still remember us and do so much for us. It's very heart-rending to think that there are people like that yet in this world.
We'd be done without the Americans.
These guys are very brave. They were brave then when they were young, flying over here. And they're brave now, they're older, to come back, what with all the problems over there. And we think they're a marvellous example. Lovely guys. God bless the veterans of the 8th, and God bless America.
That's right. And everyone.
Amen.
Holy Trinity would like to welcome the veterans, wives and friends of the 467th Bomber Group. It's lovely to see you again. 4 years ago we saw you and we thought that was the end, but you've come back again.
Sidney Katz is more than glad to be back at Rackheath, home of the 467th Bomb Group. As a radio countermeasures operator, he flew with 22 different crews.
And I said, you know, this may sound nonsensical, but I saw an airplane without a propeller. We're back, a little older, a little wiser, but you know what? It may sound a little corny. I still would have done it. And I'm glad I did. Great adventure, great being part of something. And it's just great to be back.
Beth May is the niece of pilot Jack Brinson.
What's it like being back with your family?
This is wonderful. This has just been a very special time for us. Makes you really proud to be an American. It's been really great.
So who are you here with this trip?
Jack Brinson from Monticello, Florida.
Well, what did he do during the war?
He was a pilot. He was here for about 10 months, I think.
Alicia Maris is the daughter of Anthony Maris.
What has it meant to your dad to have you here?
I think he's appreciated it a great deal because I think he thinks now the story will be passed along much better and that we'll understand the next generation. And also, I think he wants us to bring our kids back here.
The beer used to flow at the Green Man for the 467th, and it still does. Son of pilot Bruce Palmer finds his dad's picture.
That's my dad right there.
So what does it mean for you to be with your dad?
Well, it's such a important part of history in our family, and I think in U.S. history and British history as well. And it ties in so well with what's going on in the world today, the partnership of Britain and the United States. I wish a lot more of my generation had been able to come with their parents. Maybe next time.
The 467th Memorial at the old air base, Rackheath. David and Jean Hastings' son, Roger, owns a business right next to it.
Keeping an eye on the memorial for us?
Yes, we do. We were polishing it, put new flags up a couple of weeks ago, so try and keep it all neat and tidy.
One, two, three, more beer. Yeah.
This is the geriatric squadron.
Oh, Saratan Alley.
There you go.
The last look at the control tower at Rackheath. It might not last much longer.
The runway is along those trees there, and it went along toward on the side of the trees.
Which way, Dan?
Toward that way.
There's the steps. And that's where you have a picture of Colonel Shower standing on that balcony.
Yeah, go stand right there. Yeah.
The last picture.
Ready, right there, stop.
That's where you watch the planes coming in.
Yeah, they go across like that. David, you pointed out better than I can. But the runway was still there about in 87. You could still see it.
Joan Dzenowagis is the daughter of navigator Joseph Dzenowagis.
I remember when we had Colonel Shower up there on that balcony there, and everybody was so paranoid, they said, "You're way too old to climb up that thing." And he said, "Hell, I climbed up that every single day for years." And he wouldn't take no for an answer.
It's a pretty neat tower, huh?
Yeah, I really would like to climb around in there. You can get in there, scavenge some junk. That was something.
The Sal House Lodge, a farewell to English friends.
Henry Cornelian. They're all just that little bit older and gray-haired, but it's difficult to remember them all. Dark-haired and taking Norwich to pieces, as I'm sure they did in 1944. Still, it's great to see them back. Regret we can't see now is see the airplanes flying over. To see our whole host of Liberators flying back over Rackheath would be great.
Brian Mahoney is preserving the legacy of the 467th through a book he has written about his late father, Colonel James Mahoney.
Quieting, relentless, and prime, his own need to make sense of what he and his contemporaries experienced. I came to realize that more than just the memoir value and the personal value, you know, is good storytelling, that Dad as a historical source, really, you know, his stuff deserved to go into the historical record.
Hi.
Nice to meet you. Andy.
He's a native, but he's an air traffic controller.
For years, Andy Wilkinson has been the historian for the 467th Bomb Group.
He's taken a keen interest in all this 8th Air Force stuff and done a lot of good work. He has a great website.
It's a wonderful occasion to actually have the opportunity to see the veterans over here. And possibly the last time we can expect to see them over in any large numbers, I guess. So we savor this opportunity. I think it's a very warm relationship, and it's enduring, and it'll endure long after the last man has passed on.
McKenna Dempsey, the 10-year-old grandson of Colonel James Mahoney, and Brian Mahoney's nephew, is here too.
McKenna James Dempsey.
What should other kids know about World War II and their relatives who might have served?
They should know that their relatives were very brave and strong to do that, and that what they did was a very good thing.
Do you think you'll ever be back to England?
Yeah, I think I will. I enjoyed it a lot, and I think a lot of other kids would like to visit here too.
Good to see you again, even briefly.
Yes, indeed. It's fascinating. We've really, really loved having you over here, as you may have gathered.
Are you ours? Do you belong to us?
There it is.
Wonderful. Have you seen the one we put up?
What a marker. What a night. What a week. Brilliant.
It's similar.
Thousands of Americans are remembered in villages and cities across England. Their names are engraved in stone at the American Cemetery and on the Wall of the Missing, carved on markers and memorials, pondered in fields of daffodils, spoken in places of worship, written in books of remembrance. In the heart of the 2nd Air Division Memorial Library in Norwich, for all to see and to remember those who gave their lives in the fight for freedom.